a solid layup that Christmas, and Larry got the rebound. And as soon as he threw the ball, I was like, oh, I know exactly what's about to happen. But I was still like, the video doesn't do it justice. I feel like the video on the internet doesn't do any justice for that dunk, because watching it live and being on the baseline, if you look on the bench, I might have or may not have fainted.
Welcome to another episode of the CJ McCollum Show. I'm joined, as always, by Izzy Gutierrez, and we have a special guest who also plays for the New Orleans Pelicans. He goes by the name of Trey Murphy. We are recording this podcast in Utah in between games. We have a little vacation in Utah where we dropped the first game. We'll play them Thursday night at 7 p.m. Mountain Time, and then we'll travel to play the great Phoenix Suns once again for the third time in a week. But
you got to do one of these real quick. Just get that game out of your system from last night. Just get that all out of there, because that game was some nonsense. I don't even know what was going on. But let's forget about that one.
That was hey, a Trey, rough game.
Absolutely.
Real quick, before we start asking you anything, I want to add, because Trey Murphy III, you know, you got two Treys in the name. Obviously, got to be a three-point shooter there. Your real name's first name is Kenneth, right?
Oh yeah, that's my
full
name.
I bring this up because my favorite nickname is Buddy Hield, because his real name is Chavano Rayner Hield. And so Trey, it's Kenneth. It's not that crazy, but how'd you get the nickname Trey?
I mean, really, it was because I am the third Kenneth, and so that's why they named me Trey. So really, Trey Murphy III isn't like a real thing, but Murphy III is real, and I go by Trey. So they just put them together, and it sounds pretty cool. So we just go along with it.
Okay.
So it could be Kenneth Murphy III.
It's not could be. That's what it actually is. But oh,
wow. I didn't know that I'm your teammate. That's crazy.
Yeah, I don't tell people my real name a lot. So
I don't think Buddy Hield does either.
Yeah.
Chavano.
Neither does Tremonte or whatever Ja Morant's name is.
Right. something like that.
Demetrius or something, whatever his name is.
There it is.
But let's get started. Let's talk a little bit about growing up in Durham. I say that right? Durham, North Carolina.
Sure.
Talk a little bit about what your upbringing was like in Durham, North Carolina, the recruiting process that you went through, and how you ended up at Rice before transferring to Virginia. Because I think a lot of people don't understand the true story of that process that you went through, playing in COVID, not having the red shirt because of the COVID year, and what went into that.
So growing up in Durham, I lived probably like 15 minutes away from downtown. And that's where a lot of the basketball activities were happening. And my mother and my father, I was living with them in the suburban part of Durham. And, you know, I would just go to practice every day, like just work on my game. And, you know, when I first started, I was 5 years old and I didn't score 1 point the entire season. And I used to run up and down the court with my hands in my pockets. So, you know, somebody would pass me the ball, just hit me in the chest. So I wasn't really focused on basketball at that age. And then my dad was like, look, you're not going to embarrass me like that ever again. So we got to the gym. We started working that six and under league year. Got a lot better, you know, scored a few more points. But overall, like, I was never really like that guy on my team until around like my junior year in high school. So once I finally got my license, I was able to take myself to the gym. And I found like a new just love for basketball, I would say. Like before, like I liked playing basketball, but my junior year is when I really started loving like playing basketball. And so that's why my recruitment was parsed a little late. I was also like going into high school, I was like 5'8". And I left high school around like 6'5". So during the time where I was being recruited my junior year, I was around like 6'3". Like 155-ish pounds, something like that. And so there were schools that were recruiting me. Like Virginia was recruiting me at first, but I was so small. They were like, we don't know if he's able to play at the ACC level. Like he can shoot really well, but really small. I don't know if he's going to be athletic enough. And it hurt me at first, but looking back on it now, it's like, all right, yeah, they were being realistic at that time. I was too small, but I grew a lot. And then I started working out in the weight room a lot more. And I ended up leaving high school at around 6'5", like 180 pounds. Oh, no, 170 pounds. That's how much I weigh. 6'5", 170 pounds. And out of high school, I probably had like six offers. And it was Rice University, Rider University, Presbyterian College, Tennessee Tech. Who else was in there? Army and Navy.
Oh, had... could have been in the Patriot League, man.
Yeah, no. <That's right>. Yeah, I actually visited Army, and it's a beautiful campus. But what kind of like stirred me away was the boxing class. I was looking at the boxing class, and one of these girls was in there, and she was just whooping this dude. And I was like, there's no way I could go into that and get whooped and have to go to practice the next day. I couldn't do it. Like, I said, nah, I can't do this. So I was like, nah, I can't do the Army. But yeah, in all honesty, Rice was my best option for me academically and athletically. And going into college, I was like, you know, I want to play professional basketball. I don't know exactly what level I'll be able to play it realistically, but I know going to Rice, I'll be able to get a good job after college. So that was my focus at the time. And then once I got to Rice, I ended up gaining like 15 pounds that first freshman summer. And, you know, didn't play a lot. The first game, actually, I'll tell you this story. First game, we're at Penn. And my entire family's there. And I'm slated to play like a good amount of minutes this game because, you know, I'm one of the better freshmen on the team. First half, I play like 5 minutes and I don't go in for the rest of the game. And that was like the first time I'd ever experienced like not really playing like that. And it was probably the most important thing that happened to me in my college career because I was just like, I never want to have this feeling again. Like, it made me work even harder. And it helped me understand, like, no matter what you think, like, you have to just control what you can, like, control what you can control. That was a quote one of my coaches gave me, and he was just saying, just control what you can control. Like, you can't control if your coach plays you, all you control is your attitude and your effort. So that helped me a lot my freshman year.
You know what's funny, Trey, I sort of get fascinated sometimes when I hear, you know, guys' path to the league and when they sort of recognize that that was a goal or a realistic goal, right? And so one of the things that's just made me laugh, first of all, 6'5", 170, like, I'm 5'10", 170, 6'5", 170. You must have been just rail thin. Yeah, right? But you said definitely. You got your license and can take yourself to the gym, and then that sort of opened up your ability to just practice more, like little details like that a lot. So what was it before? You just literally didn't have a ride to the gym, so you couldn't work as hard on your game. So once you could take yourself there, it was, hey, I can work harder on my game and I can see the improvements faster?
I wouldn't necessarily say that. I would just say that, I mean, a lot of times I would just have to shoot outside in the front yard, which, like, I was fine with. But, you know, once I was able to get into the gym, I just think that summer, I mean, I had access to the gym basically 24/7 in my school. And so when I was able to get there all the time, I just stayed there and I just fell in love with it. I couldn't tell you exactly what it was, but I think it was just me just committing myself to it my junior year.
You say you went from 6'5", 170 to about 185, didn't play much in your first career game at Rice University, and that kind of motivated you and drove you to want to work harder and never have that feeling again. You talked about wanting to become a professional athlete and realizing that Rice could provide that for you, but not knowing which level it was. At what point in your collegiate career did you realize you could play in the NBA and not just any professional league, but specifically the NBA?
Yeah, so the summer going into my sophomore year, I had grown to about 6'7", and I was about 200 pounds. And, you know, I was looking at that draft class that year. I was looking at Cam Reddish and, you know, a few of those other bigger jumbo wings. And they were getting drafted really high. And I was like, I don't see how my measurables don't stack up to theirs. Like, given another year of college basketball, like, I could see myself being in their position. So it was one of those things where it was like, all right, I'm really close, but still really far. So, like, I actually feel like I have a chance to get there. And I would say, like, my sophomore year, I definitely played a lot better, but it still wasn't to my liking. And so I had to make a really tough decision on transferring And a lot of it had to do with me just not being happy at Rice and just wanting to, you know, have a change of scenery. And so that's when I went to transfer portal. And when I tell you, it was insane. At first, though, like when the first part of the transfer portal came out, I was getting calls, and you know, I was getting calls from like UT Chattanooga and UNC Wilmington and schools like that. And I was like, hold up, I know I didn't leave Rice to make a lateral move. Like I wasn't trying to do that. But you know, one of my trainers, he told me like, yeah, like the big dogs, they wait a little bit. They try to look at film a lot more before they call you, just to make sure they're, you know, when they call, like they're really interested. And then like after a couple of days passed, that's when the call started flooding, and I ended up having around like 40 offers out of the transfer portal. And you know, I was getting calls from Jay Wright, Shaka Smart, Tony Bennett, obviously, and you know, a bunch of other, you know, legendary coaches. And it was just like a blessing for me. I was so thankful at the time just to, you know, feel like all these coaches felt like I could really help them and they could help me get to where I wanted to be. And, you know, it was tough at first because I wanted to spite Virginia for not recruiting me in high school. But I was like, you know what, I need to make a good decision for my future. So, you know, I'll say this too, though, like in the transfer portal, I was probably like for like a week in the transfer portal, I was going to Villanova. It was like a done deal. Like I was like, yeah, I'm going to go to Villanova. I really like it. And then Coach Bennett, he had a Zoom call with me because it's during COVID, you know, you can't go to, you know, the campuses. And on the Zoom call, he broke down film with me from my Rice games. And I was like, so caught off guard because every coach that I talked to, they're just trying to sing my prayers and say like how great I am and everything. But Coach Bennett was one of the only ones that, you know, critiqued some things that I was doing and felt like he could help me in these areas to get better. And that's when I, you know, like a light switch kind of cut off and I was like, yeah, I think this is the right choice for me.
Do you remember what some of those critiques were?
Yeah. So he was really big on, obviously he's really big on defense. And before I got to Virginia, I played absolutely no defense whatsoever. Like that wasn't my thing. But he would pull up these clips and he was like, see, I saw you make those two slides right there, and I know you have potential to be a great defender. And I'm looking at him like, are you sure you looking at the right film that I'm looking at right now? Because I don't know exactly what you're talking about. But he was just like, look, I can tell like you have a bright future in becoming a good defender because you move laterally, and you're also long. And so, you know, you could mold into one of those DeAndre Hunter type of guys. And, you know, that's what we've been looking for, is a bigger wing defender for our team, you know, to hopefully repeat, because at the time they were the reigning champions.
That's cool. That's a cool anecdote right there. You talking about the film breakdown. I've heard legendary stories about the transfer portal. Obviously, I've never entered it. So you're telling me you go from six offers out of high school, right? You end up choosing Rice. You enter the transfer portal and you get over 40 offers after about a week from the likes of Jay Wright, you know, probably Bill Self, a lot of those different coaches who are, you know, legendary Hall of Famers. You think you're going to Villanova, change your mind. You go to Virginia. You get to Virginia. Reluctantly going to Virginia because they didn't recruit you right away. When you get on campus, you begin to obviously practice with the team. You realize that you're playing for a team who just won a national championship. What are those feelings like when you get on campus and begin practicing? And at what point do you realize, like, this is the perfect decision for me and this is going to be everything I thought it was?
Oh, one, before I went to Virginia, I looked at their little championship documentary and it was just like, it just gave me chills. And it was one of those things where it's like, I really want to be a part of something like this. It was,
even if it's all defense and no offense. That's kind of the reputation over there.
No, it definitely is. And in all honesty, like that was one of the reasons, that's one of the main reason why I went there. Cause I said, you know, if I want to be a good professional basketball player, I got to play both sides of the ball. And so why not go to the place that has the reputation of making great defenders? And, so also I failed to mention, I like the whole time during this transfer process, I was telling teams I'm redshirting. I'm not playing this year. Like I'm going to redshirt, get stronger and then go, you know, do my thing that next year and then go to the NBA. But once I got to campus at UVA, I was one of the best players on the team, and I was like, man, like it'd be a good opportunity to play this year. Like Ty Jerome, one of my brothers, I would consider him a brother of mine. He came to one of my workouts, and after the workout, we were talking. He was like, "So, what do you plan on doing this year?" I said, "Redshirting." And he was like, "Why?" I said, "I'm trying to get stronger and then, you know, go to the league." He said, "Bro, you can get stronger in the league next year. Like, you need to play." And at the time, I was like, "Man, like, whatever. Like, that's not happening. Like, I'm not going to just play this year and then go to the league." But the more I thought about it, I was like, well, this is a COVID year. It's a free year. Might as well play. And it's not like I'm not going to be playing a lot. I'm going to be playing starters minutes. Because at first I wasn't starting. And then after like the third game, I started for Virginia and got on the ground running. And it was a great experience. It's a super, super professional program there at Virginia. I feel like it helped me a lot this year and, you know, within my pro career because of how professional they are.
Well, just to give listeners an idea, you went from at Rice your second year shooting 43% from the field and 36 from three to your 1 year at Virginia shooting 50% from the field, 43 from three. And, you know, the attempts weren't as much, but obviously a lot more efficient. Like, what was it that got even your shot more efficient just in that 1 year?
Well, Tony Bennett is a big reason for that. He, you know, has our little shot prep things that we do before practice. He has a lot of different shooting drills that we do. And he also focuses on taking good shots. So, like, you're not – like, your chances lower if you're taking, you know, highly contested shots and you're not moving the ball. Like, and so most of my shots were open, and I was able to knock down open shots. And also, he can shoot the ball really well himself. Like, if y'all didn't know, I think he is the leader in the NCAA of three-point field goal percentage, if I'm not mistaken. And so, you know, me and him used to have a few competitions, and I think that would bring out the competitive nature of my shooting too.
Yeah, that's cool. I've heard he has a nice jump shot, and it's nice to have coaches who can actually get out there and show you as opposed to just telling you. That also is definitely very helpful when you can kind of compete. And the transition is, you know, obviously you get drafted, you end up being with the Pelicans, you get drafted first round, I think 17th pick. You play some your rookie year, you end up going to the G League for a little bit and coming back. What was that rookie year like? And then you get a taste of, you know, obviously playing in the playing game, playing in the playoffs, having some big moments. And then we transition into this year, but I'll go back to last year. What was it like getting drafted to the Pelicans? Obviously the season starting the way it did last year, and then it kind of changing at the latter part of the season.
No, my rookie year, I would say it was hectic, but as I talked to a lot of people, they say that's a pretty normal rookie year. Like, a lot of times rookies don't really contribute as much as, you know, some people might think. And for me, my expectations for myself were a little skewed because summer league, I was first team all summer league, played really well. Preseason, I think I averaged like 17 or so points a game, and like I was playing really well. So in my head, I'm like, all right, look, going into this rookie year, I'm going to do really well. Like, all of a sudden is going to work out for me. It's finally like my time to show myself and prove why I'm supposed to be here. And literally from about whenever the first game was till about after All-Star break, I wasn't myself. And, you know, I was, you know, struggling, you know, working through DNPs, playing a lot, not being able to contribute, just not knowing what's going on during the games. It was really rough for me my rookie year. And, you know, it was very helpful to have, you know, my player development staff with Corey Brewer and Teresa Witherspoon and Brandon DeMoss as well. They were really in my corner the entire time and helped me so much throughout my rookie year because I went through a lot of tough times because I know we were losing and I wasn't playing and I was like, I feel like I can help. Like, I feel like I can contribute. And I would get out there and then my mind would be in totally different places. And so it was tough, but, you know, just kept working and stayed consistent with my work ethic.
Quick question, CJ, because you got me down this Tony Bennett rabbit hole. Yeah, give me a guess on what you thought his best year 3-point shooting was at Green Bay. I guess it's whatever that university is.
57%.
close. You're very good at this game. 53% from three. His last year, he shot 51%. This man, career 50% three-point shooter in 4 years of college. That's nuts. So, Trey, when did you first, like, CJ, you and Trey, like, when did you guys, like, link up? At what point were you in that rookie year where CJ got traded over and you guys got to know each other?
This was right before All-Star break.
Yeah, I got traded 3 days before my son's four-week appointment. So the 7th, I got traded on like the 6th. It went through on the 7th, and I left on the 10th.
So those first few days, whatever it is, your introduction, like, what did you think? Like, when you saw Trey, your impressions of him?
Well, I thought to myself, he's tall, he's athletic, he can shoot the ball with range, and can test shots, can move his feet well laterally. And I just thought, if he works on his game, continues to get better, he can be as good as he wants to be. Like, haven't seen the way the league works, haven't seen the way the league has shifted from a, you know, wing standpoint, right? Like, tall wings are very valuable, especially when they can shoot. Like, that's the ultimate separator. And obviously, he shoots the ball with range. He shoots it efficiently, and now he's dunking on people. So I think, you know, one of the things we talked about in the summertime, I was just like, you're going to make a big leap. I don't know how big of a leap it's going to be, but you're going to make a leap because you work hard and you're going to get opportunities. It's just more about focusing on, like, how to be efficient within our offense, right? Like, catching shoots, catching attacks, going to dunk, making the game easy for yourself. And then one of the things I told him about in the summer was just tightening up your ball handling, not to use it for now, but to be able to rely on it later. Similar to how Mikal Bridges plays, right? And I'm not saying he's Mikal, yeah, but like the way he uses his handles has kind of evolved over the years. You know, first he was catching, shooting the corners, not really wanting to shoot threes, right? Like dunking, cutting, doing that type of stuff. And then he kind of evolved into catching, shooting from the wings. Then he kind of evolved into a one or two dribble pull up. And now he can kind of run pick and rolls if he needs to. But I would just want him to think about his game 3 years from now, right? Like dribbling the spots, being able to elevate and using his size. So I think I was just impressed with the way he works. Because a lot of young guys, they don't work hard, or they feel like they should just play because they're first round picks.
Or they think they're a finished product when they get to the league, you know, like they can't improve anymore. And it's funny, Trey, because like, I can't say I paid attention too much to the games you played last year, but I went to the preseason game in Miami. I think your second to last preseason game this year. And I'm watching, and every time you shot, I was like, the net's not moving. Like every single time it was just clear. And I was like, all right, I'm going to keep my eye on this guy. And then like, as the season goes, it's just crazy impressive. And I think based on what you told us about your past is like, you're sort of re-realize what you're capable of and then just push toward it and try to push past it, right? And it feels like you're in the league now, but still have, like CJ saying, all this room for growth. Like if you were to assess yourself and then basically say again, hey, what's my potential? How would you assess that? Like from right now?
From right now, I would say I feel like I'm not really even scratching the surface of what the type of player I could be. Like in my mind, I don't see why I couldn't be an all-star down the road. I don't see why I couldn't be, you know, one of the greater players to play the game. Like I really had that vision for myself because of the measurables as well as skill set and, you know, working hard as well as, you know, just thinking the game. I feel like as long as I put everything together, I feel like I could accomplish anything I really want to. And, you know, I try not to limit myself because I know how strong, you know, the brain is when it comes to stuff like that. When you really set your mind to something, like there's just endless things that you can do. And I realized that through my college years because, you know, I would limit myself and say, all right, maybe I'm not there yet. And then, you know, I would have like a game or two where I do something like spectacular. I'm like, all right, I see what type of player I can be. And so really just not even putting those limits on myself because, you know, I know how strong my brain can be and holding me back sometimes.
I know you surprised me once or twice this year. What a play or two this year that surprised you?
I mean, the one that probably stands out is the dunk down the middle.
Against the two hands. Yeah.
the two hands to one hand.
Right.
Yeah. And what's crazy is so when Billy swung it to me in the middle, I knew they were going to be closing out really hard. And I was waiting for Murray to step in, like full body help. And he just stunted and went back. And as soon as he did that, I just jumped. And then I realized, I was like, oh, I'm not going to be able to dunk this with two. I'm a little too far. And then I dunked with one, and I fell. And I was like, whoa, no way. I just did that. So That was a really cool moment. And then literally next play down, went down the lane, dunked it again. I was pretty hyped about that.
Yeah, the athleticism is showing for sure. I think people are definitely closing out closer because of the shot reputation that he has now. He's able to use athleticism to get to the rim, but I don't think people understood how athletic he was. And I think he's displaying that consistently. You talked about not playing a lot, right? Your rookie year, playing the G League some, obviously coming on strong, you know, during the playing game and our postseason series against the Suns. What was your thought process like going into that summer? And how have you translated that work to success this season? Obviously, you're averaging about 12 points per game, shooting well from three, shooting well from the field, been getting a lot of starters minutes or starting. Obviously, we've been injured and a lot of guys been out of rotation, but you've kind of solidified yourself as a guy who can play at this level, obviously, and is continuing to carve out a larger role. So what was your preparation like, and how are you continuing to still prepare during the season?
Yeah, so literally since my junior year of high school, like I look at the summer as like there's no way I'm not getting better at one thing or two things within the summer. And so I really lock in into the summer and, you know, figure out things I like that I want to work on. And, you know, I kind of crave like the off season sometimes, like towards the end of the year, because I know like I'm really excited about like the process and like getting better. And, you know, this last summer I was looking at, you know, making sure I got more athletic, you know, stronger, as well as worked on my ball handling and as well as movement shooting. Like those are like the main three things that I wanted to, you know, focus in on, because I knew down the line, like you said, like I'll have to use, you know, my ball handling skills, whether that's not this year or next year, like down the road. And I want to make sure I build that foundation now in order to, you know, be really comfortable with it as my career progresses. And obviously the strength part, like you're playing against grown men, and I wouldn't say I'm, you know, developed into my body yet. So just continuing to get stronger, you know, be able to withstand different bumps and pressure from other guys so I can hold my ground.
You don't look crazy thin anymore though. Like, do you feel like you're a little skinny out there, or do you feel like I can pretty much hold my own?
For the most part, I feel like I can hold my own.
I mean, not against Zion, but against other people.
Oh, yeah, absolutely not. No, training camp with Zion was something different. But, no, nah, like, I feel like I can hold my own. But then, you know, I'll get hit with a screen or two where it's like, ah, yeah, I need to go to the weight room or keep going to the weight room because, you know, these dudes here are really strong. Like, there's a lot of guys in the league that, you know, are really grown men. But I don't let it, you know, affect me too much.
What would you say is the best part of this Pelicans team? First question. Second question is, how has Willie's leadership style and coaching style impacted you as a young player in this league?
I'll say by far the best part of our Pelicans team is just our chemistry. I feel like it's a high school or a college locker room. Like, we all really get along with each other, and, you know, we all root for each other, and there's no real egos on the team. And I feel like it's really, really rare to have that in an NBA team. And I'm very thankful to be a part of that because, you know, especially with the way my rookie year went, if it was on a team that, you know, was dysfunctional, it could have went south like really quick. And, you know, having, you know, just as my rookie class guys with Herb and Jose, they were both very helpful in my rookie year because they were just always supporting me. As well as Brandon Ingram too, because, you know, tall, skinny guy from North Carolina, we kind of looked out for each other in that type of way. And yeah, I would say that's the most special part about our Pelicans team is our chemistry. And then I also say Coach Green's leadership style is also very important because, you know, our NBA season is very chaotic. And I would say he's more like a calming voice. So, you know, when everything is going so rampant and, you know, just crazy, he's more of like a steady voice that's, you know, able to lead us but still like get on us about stuff that we need to be, you know, being better about. So I really appreciate what he does as a coach and the way he, you know, exemplifies his leadership.
You got any more, CJ? Because I want to ask something to both of you, that something a recent occurrence, but I want to make sure you got all your questions out.
No, my only other question was going to be why he chose Excel Sports Management as his representation, because I also chose them.
Oh, man. And I'm going to tell a story about this, too, because when you asked about CJ's first impression when he first met me, I'll tell you my first impression, because the first time we spoke, I told him that we were in Excel. And then literally 3 days later, he asked me, he was like, "Wait, are you in Excel?" And I was like, "Yes, CJ. I literally told you this 3 days
He told
ago."
me. He told me twice.
Never listened to me.
And I was like, "I see where his mind is at right now." He was
I
like,
just
"I'm
got
with you. I know."
traded. I had just got traded. I had a baby.
Right.
My mind was all over the
And
place. I was like, damn, I did ask you that 3 days ago.
so
was like,
first
yep.
impression, not the best.
I was like, yeah, it's cool, whatever, fine.
Like, CJ don't listen to nothing I'm saying.
Yep, that's exactly what I was thinking. But no, Excel, it was down to about three agencies. And at the end of the day, Excel was just the most comfortable agency that I was with. And, I really like my agent a lot, Sean Kennedy. He's a great dude. And I feel like I could relate to him. And he could also just be 100% honest with me. Like during the whole draft process, like even during the recruiting part, because I didn't commit to the draft until the day before the combine. But during the whole draft process before then, like he never told me I was going to go in a certain range. He would just say, "You're in a good position," or "You could be in a better position if I do this, that, and the third." And I really appreciated that from him, because there were so many agencies that were like, if you go with us, we have a promise from a team, and we know that you're going to go from 10 to 20, blah, blah, blah. And this is like, you don't know that. Like, and that's why I feel bad for a lot of these kids, because they get trapped into hearing what these agencies have to say. Because an agency could be like, "Look, we have a promise from this team." And if the guy doesn't know any better, they could be like, "Oh, wow, like that's all I need to hear." And then they sign with an agency, and then it's just not the case. And so I really appreciate Excel for their honesty, as well as just the overall family dynamic that they have. Like, there's not one person I've met in the entire agency that I didn't like. And they are just, first class. It's really, really first class service.
All
A
right,
great
maybe I should
answer.
change agencies. Do they have a media department?
They do. They
All
actually
right.
do. They actually do. And no, I don't get a percentage.
I will be looking into that. So here's my two things. One, it has to do with yesterday's game, and it's not about the result, because clearly the Jazz messed with the rims and none of those shots went in that you guys were shooting. But I was at the different show I was on. I did I said something about Walker Kessler, kind of dismissive, right? I was just like, "Oh, the Utah Jazz, they have Walker Kessler on their team." And I was just like, I didn't know who he was. Then I got a text from Bomani Jones a couple of days later, who said, and whenever Bo texts you, you got to listen, right? And he's just, "Hey, Walker happened to be like a five-star recruit for Auburn." Like, he, and I was like, "Oh, okay, well, I didn't know who he was." And then after I watched him play, I was like, "Man, this guy can do some things." So I'm officially apologizing to Walker. I think he had like a maybe a double double last night, but
Unfortunately, he did.
right?
Yep, he
I don't
did.
even know what happened in that game. I think I was dizzy watching it. But I want to go back to that Phoenix game and the finish and Zion's dunk. And I'll give you my take on it, because I loved it. Like, it's not just, an unwritten rule thing, right? But this is Zion at home giving the people at home what they want against a rival, like he said. Against, he took out my teammates last year, all that. But even just from a fan perspective, it's not like he went up there and laid it up like Rudy did, right? He gave you the Zion dunk. And so I just wanted to know at the moment what you guys were thinking when it happened, and then just a little bit of the fallout after that.
Do you want to go first, CJ, or me?
Age before beauty. So I'll go first. I think when Larry got the rebound, first I thought to myself, all right, they're gonna foul Larry. And then Larry kind of palmed the ball and looked and was like, "I don't want to shoot these free throws. Here you go, Zion." And he threw it to Z, and Z kind of looked and he started slow strolling. And I've seen him slow stroll before, like, because that's like his windup. He did, most guys like run fast to dunk it. He kind of just like methodically dribbles, kind of at an angle, and then he just takes off like a superhero.
I don't know if you heard, but the announcers at the time were saying, "Oh no,
No,
oh no."
they knew what was coming too. And when he wound up, I thought to myself, like, what type of dunk is he going to do? And when he started spinning, I said, "Oh, he's going for a 360. Oh, he's going for a 360 windmill." And he dunked it so hard. I just thought to myself, damn, he jumped so high, so forcefully, so quick. And then he still did a jackhammer. And that was after playing like 37 minutes. Like, the conditioning that he has to be in, the power, the force, the strength that he kind of displayed on that was like a, it was like he's let out all the frustration of having to watch us lose last year and having to kind of face the question marks of, can he do this? Can he do that? Is he going to be in shape? Will he be able to return? Can he be himself again? That was the exclamation mark on the, I am exactly who I thought I was, and I am exactly who you guys thought I was, and here I am. And that was a great way to end that game. And obviously, you know, some fans didn't like it, but I think you play till zeros and you can argue you shouldn't score at the end of games. But if you're going to do it, that's how you do it. I think if, you, if you're going to do it, you don't go do no punk, like no little, you know, I'm just trying to get 2 points. You right. Leave the statement dunk that makes them think like, oh, that's what you want? And it's like, yeah, that's exactly what I'm on.
Is that what you thought, Trey?
Yeah, so I had a different angle because I was on the bench at the time. And just my thoughts, I saw the layup that Chris missed, and Larry got the rebound. And as soon as he threw the ball, I was like, oh, I know exactly what's about to happen. But I was still – like, the video doesn't do it justice. I feel like the video on the internet doesn't do any justice for that dunk, because watching it live and being on the baseline – if you look on the bench, I might have or may not have fainted after the dunk. and so I was very amazed. Like, that's one thing like about me. I don't really get amazed by people and like plays on the court, but Zion, he does that. Like, he's a different dude. Like, I've never seen anything like it. And, you know, I was happy for him in that moment because of all the backlash and all the criticism he got last year when he wasn't able to play. Especially with a foot injury, that is tough. Like, you can't do, like, there's not much you can do. And, you know, I was glad he did it because, you know, I like seeing a show. And it was absolutely a show. And, you know, I commended him for it. And I was like, yeah, nah, put the statement on there.
What about the other side, too? Like, did it make you feel good that he just did that for y'all, right? Because it was, essentially, the way he said it, it was for my teammates from last year. And take that. Like, that in terms of a leadership moment, like, that's a pretty good one, even though some people would say, you know, unnecessary. I think for a leadership moment, I think that's pretty decent. No,
I think his reasoning was mature, because I don't know if I would have had the maturity to say something like that at 22. I might have said, I just wanted to dunk because I've been hurt and I'm playing again, and I didn't like the way the season went last year, and I didn't like what was said about me, and I didn't like the way the Suns went about whooping our team, like, you know what I mean, like, because mm-hmm. they beat us, and you know. Obviously, we lost in six, but one of those games we lost by 18 or 19, Mikhail dunks it at the end. Like, the way they beat us was, you know, like, it left a sour taste in everybody's mouth. So I think, obviously, it's just a regular season, so it is what it is. Like, we got a lot of games left to be played, and that's a team that's been in the finals. You know, they've been in the playoffs consistently. We got a ways to go before we're at that level where we're consistently being in the playoffs and being a finals contender, but it was a step in the right direction for us to win at home.
Who's I got one more random question. Who's your Trey? Who's your football team, NFL team?
The Eagles. And let me say, I've been an Eagles fan since like 2012. So please don't call me bandwagon.
Yeah, I was hoping you were going to say that, because Michael Parsons was on a podcast recently. That's the Dallas Cowboys defensive end, and he said he basically just tried to imply strongly that Jalen Hurts was not the reason, or didn't really deserve a whole lot of credit. It's the rest of the team that's really good. And whether or not you believe that, doesn't really matter. What I'm curious about is, like, when other players, because like CJ does his pod, still playing, and like, he's not going to go like trash somebody else. He's not going to do it because, you know, it's going to come back to bite him. But just the idea of saying that as another active player, that's a diss, right? That's like an insult. Like, you can't go ahead and just say that publicly just because you happen to be like on a podcast, like it's being recorded. I don't know. To me, I thought that sort of crossed the line for Mike. I think he probably shouldn't be making those assessments, especially when you lost to him.
Yeah, no, that's the way I look at it, is like, you should mainly worry about yourself and everything that you're doing. If you're outwardly talking about other people, that's just, you know, really talking about your own shortcomings that you have, and maybe you just don't feel as confident in your team. And it's like, I know myself, I'm not going to be speaking about another team or any other players in a negative way, because they're not my focus. My focus is on myself and the Pelicans. Like, that's all I worry about. And, you know, especially with them being a divisional rival, it's just like, we can tell, like, you're not too happy. Like, you're a little salty about the way things are going, and which is understandable. But, you know, the Eagles obviously we're gonna win the division. So I mean, it's okay. Like you'll be all right. Maybe you can get it back next year.
Yeah, it kind of sounds like a bitter ex when you do that. And I think the other part is they beat you. They beat you handily, right? They're dominating, and Jalen Hurts is playing well. It's not like he's a game manager. Like he is dominating. Yeah, like he's not managing games. He's taking over games. So I think if you're gonna be critical of other teams, other players while still playing in the league, make it factual. Don't make it opinion based. If it's factual based on statistics or analytics or things that you can actually back it with, then by all means, go do it. I would never do that. But if I'm going to talk about somebody, it's going to be quite frank, Dawn. I shot poorly last night. Like, you can't argue that, like, right? Like, 6 of 17, or like somebody that's a friend of mine in the league that might have shot poorly. I can say, like, they shot poorly, and they would agree because the statistics show that they shot poorly. I wouldn't say he sucks. you know what I mean? Because we're all professionals.
If people, if Carson Wentz would have played those last three games that one year where they won the Super Bowl, he would have won MVP. And Jalen Hurts' numbers are the same, like this, except less interceptions. You know, more running touchdowns, whatever, but it's the same. Anyway, totally random. Sorry to get that out there.
No, that's crazy that you talked about that too, because Nick Foles, man, bless his heart, man. Nick Foles won us a championship, beat the GOAT.
You know what they call him. You know what they call him, Philly.
You know what they're calling Brock Purdy these days.
Mr. Relevant now.
Nah, it's in the same neighborhood. Rhymes with the
Oh, home. Man. Oh, man. I'm gonna go with the podcast version.
Yeah, brother. Yeah, I know what to call it now, but Nick Foles' name is still legendary to me, man. That's
for sure.
That's the biggest bar. But Trey, I appreciate you coming on. I don't have anything else. You got anything else for him?
No, I'm good. That was great. Thanks, Trey.
Yeah, thank you for taking some time, brother. I'll let you get back to the video games and the headset and lock in, man. We gotta get this one on Thursday, man. We gotta
figure that one out.
We gotta get back on the right foot, man. But I appreciate you coming on. I'm gonna shoot you a text. I got a sprinter leaving at 6:45 for dinner.
Gotcha, brother. Appreciate y'all as well. Thank you for having me on.
Nobody yes, vacations in Utah. Well, maybe in the winter. So I guess you're probably
Park
in
City. Park City.
All right, y'all.
All right.
Thanks, peace. Trey.
I'm coming to get my iPad too.
All right, man.
So CJ, I'm pretty sure you saw this, but the league is changing up some of the awards. They have they're naming the MVP award after Michael Jordan, had the new trophy, which looks really cool. A lot of details that are pretty interesting there. I did see the one that they're adding though. They're adding a clutch player of the year, the Jerry West Award, they're calling it. And the first thing people say is he went 1-8 in the finals. Why is he the clutch player? It's because he had a lot of clutch shots before those finals, and it's not all about winning the championships to be clutch. But I wanted to get your thoughts. Like, I'm sure you had some opinion on this, right? Some say, maybe not some say, but definitely an opinion heard, no?
I may have been privy to some of this stuff that was occurring in terms of the design, in terms of the awards. I don't get the... It's not like CJ, what CJ says goes. I don't want to paint that picture of like, sure, this was my idea. I designed the trophies. I came up with the names. I released it. But we do give feedback on what we think about it and our personal opinions on certain things. I think the trophies look really cool. I think the question that I'm going to put out there is, do I get a most improved trophy since I won it, you know, some years ago in 2016, do I get this version?
Were they not giving away trophies in 16 or
they gave us these little, you know, these little glass, you know, I have it, but it's not this, it's not the George Mikan trophy with Mikan going up for the layup. Like that's kind of dope. Like that would look cool in my mantle, but I think the awards are cool. Obviously, you got to honor Jordan, so I don't have any problems with that. I think all the players are obviously legends. The clutch one is going to be, you know, is it just based on this season's clutch performances? So we'll see who hits some game winners and kind of.
It's going to be very confusing. It's going to be like one of those where it's probably going to be several years before we figure out sort of the right metrics to go by. I know early on people are going to try to figure that out because we're all, you know, numbers driven and numbers obsessed. But it's strange because like are you going to give credit to the guy who made the great pass to the wide open guy in a clutch moment? And then that's, you know, a three. And that's the whole LeBron discussion from back in the day. That's going to be interesting. And then like, then you've got to put out the stats. Like you've got to put out clutch stats. I know NBA.com has clutch stats, but that's got to be like regular common information for people is to get those clutch stats out. So I think it's going to be very tricky, but I also feel like it's going to incentivize people to want to take that last shot. It's like, hey, if I can get an award out of this, it's just a regular season game. Let me take this one. And you make that one. And then all of a sudden you're going to take the next one. You're going to try to hog all the clutch shots.
Yeah. Everybody's trying to get the free throws down the stretch of games when they're fouling. Mm-hmm. So they can have that clutch free throw percentage, clutch field goal under 2 minutes, scores within 5 points. Yeah. You know how it goes. They got a staff for everything, but I think the NBA
playing hot potato with that ball. No turnovers for me.
Yeah. No turnovers, no end of game blunders, but I think the NBA got it right here. I think they consulted with the right people. I think the trophies turned out great. The designs were cool, and the timing of it just it felt like it made sense. So I think this was a win. I think it gives fans something to talk about. It gives us something to talk about as a sports journalist, and keeps us in the news stream.
Here's something to talk about before we go. Jerry West is already the logo, and now he has this award named after him. Maybe they're going to change the logo. I mean, there's two things for Jerry. That's a lot.
Your words, not mine. If they were going to change it, who should they change it to?
I mean, Kobe's the popular choice. I would like to see Kobe, but I don't think you could really go wrong if you go one of the greats, whether it be Wilt, whether it be Jordan. I don't know, but you already have the Jordan trophy, so yeah, I think you'd have to go away from Jerry.
I guess we'll find out soon enough, man. I think this was a great conversation. I hope the fans enjoy. Shout out to Trey Murphy for coming on the podcast. Hopefully we can get a win on our way out of Utah and get ready for the Phoenix Suns again before returning home. I hope people are gearing up for the holidays and able to get some time with family and relax. And I think that's it for me. You got anything else you want to leave?
The Kenneth Murphy III Most Improved Award. That's what it's going to be 75 years from now.
I like it. I like it. Speak it into existence now.
All right, Siege.
All right, have a good one.